so happy we alive.
Good evening, and welcome to Louisville Late Night. This evening, we're in beautiful San Francisco, California.
I was in one of those conversations, and then the sun came out, it was time to go home. I was going to get in my car, there's no car. And it showed up, my car was my ex-wife's car that I borrowed. And I went out and went to get in my car, and there's no car. You know, I'll show you, when a car gets, when something's missing, they don't look for it, they just look where it was. And I'm staring, I can't figure out, it's like it might materialize. And so I'm staring at where my car was, and this old wagon looks at me, hey man, is that your car? Where's your car? I said, yeah, he says, down there. Down there, and I looked down there, and the car, just for some reason, you know, said, well, I'm tired of waiting. I think I'll go down there and crash into that telephone pole. It did, for no reason. Damn the thing. The car took off, went down there, was wrapped around that telephone pole. Cold karma. Worst karma in the world. Worst karma in the world. On the other hand, pot karma, the best karma. Makes you love, makes you feel good. You're not hungry. You want to give people things. You know, cocaine's never want to give anything. You know, some people, you know, look for someone that can buy more cocaine. You want to struggle with it. Potheads, you're strangers. You're not a pot dealer. It's a loving drug. It's great. It's not even a drug. It's an herb. And it's beautiful. And cats are fussy, man. Cats are, well, you know, you have cats, you know what I mean? They're very intelligent creatures, and they won't eat just anything, you know, they have to be, you know, you got cats, you gotta fool them and everything. My cat, the first time I got him stolen, I didn't mean to, I just didn't see him in the room. And I didn't realize he was stolen until I watched him walk off a table. And he didn't land on his feet. I had mine would come back, but it will. I don't know. night started doing comedy, you know, way back. People ask us, you know, how did I get into the plot humor? Well, before plot humor, there was, we worked in a strip club, and so we used to do a lot of naked girl kind of sex jokes, you know. And then we started working in front of kids at the time, you know, back in the early 70s, 60s actually. And everybody, we were there, everybody was a pothead, you know, they're like, you know, that's what you did. And so we started having to relate to the audience, and so we started doing these pot jokes, whatever, you know, just hang out with you know, one of the audience, and we'd end up, you know, finding out where they're at, everything, and that's how we did it, you know. And I was a musician, so I had a lot of musician kind of chops, you know, looking at life through a musician's eyes was very easy, and that's how we got into the pot thing, you know. And then Cheech and I, we broke up, and it was weird, because, you know, I didn't know we were broken up for about 4 years, I don't know. Then I went to the last Cheech and Chong movie, and I was in it. And then I realized I wasn't thinking, you know, because yeah, I really missed him, man, you know. And, yeah, because he used to carry my dope for me. But he never knew it. I figured if I told him, I'd just make him paranoid. But it was true, wasn't that very paranoid? It was like the last night of the gig, you know, and the last night of any gig, you know, people throw their dope up on the stage, you know, we had time, we had hash, all sorts of good pot. You know, we tried to smoke it all in one night because we had to come down the next day. And we got through Cheech's half real easy. We couldn't put a dent in mine, you know, so he told me to throw it away. And I really went to throw it away. But somehow it ended up in my gym bag in my sock, you know. And so I was going to, you know, bring the gym bag, just walk across the border. But when I got to the border that morning with Cheech, I looked at the guy and I knew, the immigration guy, he was looking at us kind of funny, so I knew he was going to stop us. So I put the bag down. I was just going to leave the bag and walk away, and for some reason Cheech goes, I'll carry that for you, man. And you know that moment when you can save your friend's life? And you don't. I looked at him and said, okay. So we walk across the border, and you're up to the guy in the desk, and he's looking at us, and he's looking at Cheech, and he goes, hey, you, what's in the bag? And I swear to God, Cheech threw the bag on the table and says, it's full of dope, man. I kind of looked at Cheech, you know. I looked at Cheech, too. I started inching my way to the door. And then the guy looked at Cheech again and he goes, hey, aren't you guys Cheech and John? And we go, yeah. And he goes, hey, here, go on through, man. You know, and Cheech, he looked at me and goes, man, that was easy. We could have brought that dope. I said, I'll carry his bag, dog. But I don't know, man. You know, people, I walked away when Cheech and I broke up. Then I realized why we broke up. We got rich. We got rich, and I learned one thing, man. You can't make a rich Mexican do shit, bro.